Hi there. Today we are going to discuss transport in vascular plants with relation to translocation in phloem. Previously, we discussed electroosmosis, cytoplasmic streaming, and peristaltic wave hypotheses. We shall finish off with the final hypothesis, that is the mass flow hypothesis, also known as the pressure flow hypothesis. The hypothesis has a third name, that is the Munch model. Nothing to do with Cookie Monster and munching. The Munch model is a lab apparatus that can be set up to show mass flow or pressure flow happening. Let me introduce the apparatus involved. You will first need a beaker filled with distilled water and two flasks that have semi-permeable membranes. In one flask, you are to fill with sucrose solution, and in the other flask, you are to fill with starch solution. Then, you are to connect both of the flasks using a capillary tube. By just doing this setup, known as the Munch model, we will be able to see sucrose moving from the sucrose flask into the starch flask. Let me explain. Firstly, you see that the flask containing sucrose will have low water potential when comparing with the beaker containing water. So you know the rule that water will of course diffuse down the water potential gradient into the flask by osmosis. Now, when the water fills up the sucrose flask will experience high hydrostatic pressure because the water molecules now will be pushing onto the flask wall. Meanwhile, in the starch flask, we find that starch is insoluble. Since starch is insoluble, it will not affect the water potential of the flask. Therefore, the water potential of the flask containing starch and the water potential of the beaker will be the same. So, water molecules will not diffuse from the beaker into the flask containing starch solution. So because of that, the hydrostatic pressure at the starch flask will be low. Because of the difference in the content of both flasks, a hydrostatic pressure gradient has been able to develop. So, what happens next is that the water molecules along with the dissolved solutes such as sucrose will be pushed from a region of high hydrostatic pressure to the region where there is low hydrostatic pressure. Now, this movement is what we call as mass flow or pressure flow. So you are able to see how, without the use of ATP, sucrose has been able to be pushed from one location to another location due to the flow of water. Okay, so that is what we call as mass flow or pressure flow hypothesis. Let's see how well this hypothesis is accepted among biologists. One of the reasons why mass flow hypothesis is acceptable is because there are water potential gradients between different parts of plants. For example, if we take this plant here, you find that the leaves that carry out photosynthesis and produce organic molecules like sucrose do have a lower water potential, whereas roots that store starch have a higher water potential. So the gradient does exist. And for experimental purpose, scientists have also tried removing the leaves of plants, and when they do that, they find that the water potential gradient disappears, meaning that the leaves are the ones that ensure there is a water potential gradient. The second reason for accepting the mass flow hypothesis is that evidence shows that there is upward pressure in plants. The evidence was gotten from studies using a plant parasite known as an aphid. You see, these yellow bugs here are the aphids, and they are concentrated at the leaf vein where phloem is located. What the aphid does is it uses its proboscis to inject into the phloem so that it can suck the phloem sap, just like as if it was drinking juice using a straw. So when scientists did further study of this aphid, they noticed that while the aphid is sucking the phloem sap was also being released through the anus. So scientists were curious to know whether this phloem sap was being forced out by the aphid itself, or is it the pressure from inside the plant that is pushing out the phloem sap. To find out, what scientists did was they cut the aphid, leaving only its head and proboscis stuck to the plant. Now when they did that, of course this picture is a bit blur, not a bit, very blur, but trust me, the head is here and this is the proboscis, and you see the phloem sap is still being released. So that means it is not the aphid that is excreting the phloem sap, but the pressure inside the phloem that is pushing out the phloem sap. So this is the second evidence. The third evidence is based on the presence of virus in plants. Firstly, you see, viruses are insoluble. Therefore, they cannot diffuse. However, it is found that they move in the plant. Now, they cannot move physically because they do not have cilia, flagella, or pseudopodium. So that means they must be moving by floating or being pushed by the mass flow in the phloem. If I take this picture of water traveling here as an example of the mass flow in the phloem, then what happens to the virus is it just travels with the flow of the water. So these are the three evidences that support mass flow hypothesis, and of course the Munch model itself proves that it is possible to occur. Let's look at why mass flow is not accepted by some. Let's now look at the reasons why mass flow is not completely accepted. The main reason is that mass flow is unable to explain three basic knowledge about translocation. Firstly, scientists understand that translocation is a bidirectional process. Mass flow, however, cannot explain bidirectional translocation since the Munch model shows us that the sucrose will be transported only in one direction. Scientists also know that the companion cell has a specific function, and that is why it is always attached to the sieve tube. But based on the mass flow hypothesis, companion cell has no function. Finally, experiments using respiratory inhibitors have shown that translocation cannot happen if there is no ATP, meaning that translocation is an active process. But based on the Munch model, we find that translocation by mass flow is a passive process. So these three basic concepts cannot be explained by mass flow. Let's look now at more reasons why mass flow is not accepted. One is that the hydrostatic pressure between the two regions cannot be strong enough to form mass flow. And then scientists have noticed that solutes actually travel at different rates, some slower, some faster. But if they are being pushed by mass flow, then all of them should travel at the same rate. So this again is not true. Finally, scientists argue that if translocation was by mass flow, then the sieve plate is useless. Over a long period of time, the sieve plate should have disappeared, like in xylem. You see, xylem do not have any layer in between so that water can be transported without obstruction. So, in the case of mass flow, that should have happened too, but it didn't, meaning that translocation cannot be by mass flow. So, I've completed explanation on the mass flow hypothesis, and together with the previous video, you can see that none of the four hypotheses are 100% correct or 100% wrong. Okay, now to continue with our syllabus, we use the mass flow hypothesis, also known as the pressure flow hypothesis, and see how it can be adapted to the plant. Now I'm going to match parts of the Munch model to parts of the plant. The flask with sucrose is going to be the leaf. The flask with starch is going to be the root. The capillary tube that transported sucrose will be the phloem, and the beaker with water is the xylem. But in exam questions, sometimes they don't use the word leaf or root. Instead, they use the word source and sink. So source is the part of the plant that has low water potential but high hydrostatic pressure. So remember, this happens because the source will have a lot of sucrose and water will diffuse in by osmosis, causing high hydrostatic pressure. The sink, on the other hand, will have high water potential because it has starch and low hydrostatic pressure. Now, questions normally will use a cell diagram to explain mass flow involving source and sink. So here is the cell diagram. Okay, it may look a bit complicated, but it's not. It's just showing you xylem, phloem, the mesophyll cell of the leaf, and the root cell. These here are the companion cells of the phloem. So it's simple. Okay, so let me explain part by part. Let me start at the source. The source is the mesophyll cell, where a process known as phloem loading occurs. Phloem loading is when the sucrose that is synthesized by photosynthesis is actively transported from the mesophyll cell into the sieve tube. Now notice it is an active process where the energy or ATP is synthesized by the companion cell, but here they call it the transfer cell. It is a modified companion cell because it not only generates the ATP, but it also helps to transport the sucrose into the sieve tube. Now, since this is an active process, sucrose will accumulate. And this then will cause the water potential of the sieve tube that is located at the source to reduce. The change that happens at the sieve tube near the source affects the xylem. So you see the sieve tube has low water potential and the xylem will have high water potential. So naturally, water molecule then will start to diffuse from the xylem into the sieve tube by osmosis. Now once the water arrives at the sieve tube, the water will cause high hydrostatic pressure to develop. This high hydrostatic pressure then will start to push not only water but also the dissolved substance such as sucrose down the sieve tube across the sieve plate towards the sink. This process is what we call as mass flow. Now we look at what happens at the sink. Through mass flow, water molecule and sucrose will arrive at the sink. At the sink, phloem unloading will occur. This is when the sucrose that is in the sieve tube is actively transported into the root cell. Then the root cell will polymerize the sucrose to form starch. Now without the sucrose in the sieve tube, what happens to the sieve tube at the sink is it will develop high water potential. Since the sieve tube is now having high water potential, water molecules from the sieve tube at the sink will diffuse by osmosis into xylem. With the water molecules leaving the sieve tube, we find that the hydrostatic pressure of the sieve tube at the source will begin to decrease. Then these water molecules in the xylem will go back up to the source and the mass flow process will repeat. Now from the explanation, you can see that there is a continuous pressure gradient between the sieve tubes at the source, that's the leaf, and the root, that is the sink. So this pressure gradient is helping the water molecules as well as the sucrose molecules to be pushed from the source to the sink. And that process is what we call as mass flow. Okay, to overview that once again, I show you in animation. Here, the source is phloem loading, where sucrose from the mesophyll is being actively transported into the sieve tube at the source. Now, the presence of the sucrose causes the water potential at the phloem to decrease, and the high water potential at the xylem causes water to diffuse in by osmosis. So now the presence of the water increases the hydrostatic pressure of the sieve tube at the source, and this causes the water and sucrose to be pushed down by mass flow to the sink. At the sink, phloem unloading occurs where sucrose from the sieve tube is actively transported into the root cell. So because of the absence of sucrose, the sieve tube at the sink has high water potential, and this causes water to diffuse by osmosis into xylem. So when the water leaves, the sieve tube at the sink has low hydrostatic pressure. So the continuous formation of high hydrostatic pressure and low hydrostatic pressure causes a pressure gradient to always be there. So this is how mass flow occurs. Okay, on a final note, something for you to remember. It is not that the source has always got to be the leaf and the sink has always got to be the root. Plant organs can become source or sink depending on their stage of growth. That means sometimes the leaf can become the sink. Sometimes the root can become the source. Let me show you an example. From our previous discussion, we know that the leaf is going to be the source and the root is going to be the sink. But at times, it is in reverse. For example, let's look at the developing fruit here. The fruit is ripening using sucrose from the leaf. So leaf continues to be the source and the fruit will be the sink. However, in this picture, if you watch, the seed is growing a leaf. So the sucrose from the seed is going into the leaf. So this time, the seed is going to be the source, the leaf will be the sink. Likewise, over here, you see, this is a potato, ubi kledek. Okay, it's called a tuber. So from the tuber, you see leaves are growing. That means the starch will be broken down into sucrose and then the sucrose will be transported to the leaf for the leaf to grow. So the sprouting tuber will be the source, whereas the leaf is going to be the sink. So in questions, you must be very alert to remember, okay, where is the origin of the sucrose? Do not assume that the origin must always be from the leaf. Okay, in this example, it can be from the seed, it can be from the tuber, okay, depending on the time of growth. So with that, we have finally ended chapter 8. See you next time in chapter 9. Thank you and goodbye.